My presentation today is dedicated to a very special case, which I think hasn't been yet discussed in the conference, how Samizdat can or could be transferred to Tamizdat without losing its aura of unofficial art production. As I'm speaking about the Lagoon anthology, of course it has very much to do with the personality of its editor, Konstantin Kuzminsky, whom some of you knew personally. But I'll not talk so much about the different kinds of marginalization of Kuzminsky as a marginalization of himself, which indeed would be also an appropriate theme for my subject. But I'd like to concentrate on some other aspects, at first on the editorial history of the Blue Lagoon, and try to show how its distinctiveness was connected with specific art and life practices which Kuzminsky tried to transfer into Tamizdat and did it with great success. I'll speak briefly about the genre of Samizdat anthology, and will try to point out some interesting issues with copyright, and concentrate on the three main distinctive principles of Kuzminsky anthology. It's the reproduction of literaturny byt, Samizdat aesthetics, and Polish principle. Konstantin Kuzminsky, the Blue Lagoon anthology, published by Oriental Research Press in 1980-1986, is undoubtedly known to every scholar of Soviet unofficial literature. I assume that for many in the West, especially before the rise of electronic technologies, it was possibly the first, if not the only, source for studying literary Samizdat in such extent. For many in Russia, until its electronic version was released, it remained a Tamizdat legend. By its sheer scope, 5 volumes in 9 books, Kuzminsky anthology is still the largest collection of Russian unofficial poetry. Vadim Krait went so far to call it the largest Russian anthology ever. However, as you know, this unique project is less of a common anthology and more of a work of literature in itself, that reproduces, recreates, and reflects the mechanics of the two cultural fields it belonged to, Samizdat and Tamizdat. It is well known that anthology was, quite naturally, a common format for the literary reflection of Tamizdat, as it generalized the scarce knowledge about the developments beyond the Iron Curtain. But that was not the case for Samizdat. This is easy to explain. Anthology as a tool of literary canonization relies on established body of texts and positions of their authors within literary field. For Samizdat, the study of the literary scene focused on the literary process itself rather than its milestones, and the leading Samizdat format for a collection of various authors was Almanac and, after the mid-70s, literary periodicals. Quite remarkably, almost all the attempts to publish Samizdat literary anthologies, at least within Leningrad's second culture, had much to do with Kuzminsky. I quote, "I had been dreaming about anthologies since 1959. But they were impossible to do in those circumstances." End of quote. Kuzminsky confessed that in the letter to Yefim Etkind on December 25, 1975. Indeed, his career of an editor and publisher started in 1962 with a work on the second issue of the poetry almanac, Prisma, that came out at Boris Tayagin's Samizdat Beta Publishing. Later, same year, Kuzminsky switched genres and published, in collaboration with Tayagin, the Anthology of Soviet Pathology, Antologia Sovietskoy Patologii, which had been considered lost until Vladimir Orlov some time ago discovered it in the FSB archive among the files of Alexander Ginzburg. Although Kuzminsky later said that the anthology included one or two poems by all leading Moscow poets, Ginzburg's copy reveals quite a subjective approach to the choice of the authors. Orlov points out that the contents of the anthology largely coincides with the lists of poets who took part in a single reading event organized by Kuzminsky at the Leningrad Cafe Ulipka on December 23, 1962. This means that Kuzminsky follows the example of Ivan Ježov and Evgeny Shamurin, who included in their anthology Russian Poetry of the 20th Century, I quote Ježov and Shamurin, a number of young poets whose literary face has not yet become distinct but had already acquired certain original features, end of quote. But they opted for such an approach, hoping to find new poets among young workers, which was quite typical for Proletkult era, while Kuzminsky states the principle he followed all his life, to represent the literary scene in the broadest way possible, including the less known names. Все это бульон, а если кто предпочитает клёцки, или там гренки, или фрикадельки, его свободный выбор. Я выбираю бульон, Kuzminsky wrote in the letter to Геннадий Трифонов on February 9, 1987. Indeed, the Blue Lagoon later recreates the breeding ground of unofficial culture where its representatives did or did not evolve. In the early 70s, Kuzminsky undertakes the second attempt to create an anthology of Leningrad poetry. He was encouraged by a meeting with American author Susan Massie, who visited Leningrad in 1967. Kuzminsky, who worked at the time as a tour guide at the Pavlovsk Palace and by Soviet standards spoke good English, invited Massie to his literary event at the House of Cinema in Leningrad. Later he described what happened next in the following way. Сюзанна обалдев сказала, что тебе, книгу издать? Нет, я говорю, давай антологию. Соснора, Горбовский, Бродский, Кушнер, ну и я, темная лошадка. 5 лет ушло на это. Какие-то американские самодеятели графоманы переводили. Перевод читать физически невозможно. Message the Living Mirror was published in 1972 by the Doubleday Publishing House, but Kuzminsky was not content with the result and compiled his own monumental two-volume anthology under the same name, «Живое зеркало». Interestingly, Kuzminsky makes here the same gesture he later made with the Blue Lagoon. Although the anthology was based on his personal taste, he named Massie as co-author, as a person who encouraged him without actually taking part in the project. As you know, Grigory Kovalev, who was named the co-editor of the Blue Lagoon, did not directly work on it either. The two volumes of the Living Mirror, titled First Stage and Second Stage, Первый этап и Второй этап, respectively include poems by 28 Leningrad poets. As Kuzminsky explains in the preface, 14 of them are his friends, pupils, or just are his age, while the other 14 are teachers, or shall we say, elder brothers and quills. The work of each poet is preceded by a short introductory note. Kuzminsky doesn't focus on biographical details, but rather shares his personal impressions about the poems and their author, as if following the first sentence of the second volume that became his own motto, I quote, "Literature is not just text, it's also alive," end of quote. These introductory notes, which he partly used late in Mikhail Shemyakin's anthology Apollon 77 and his own Blue Lagoon anthology, reveal not only Kuzminsky's personal style that never changed, but also a particular editorial ethics towards the material and its authors. It often involved copyright issues. The most interesting cases are Yosef Brodsky and Dmitry Bobyshev, as they show a distinct difference of the editorial practices of Samizdat and Tamizdat. This is how Kuzminsky justifies free usage of text by other authors in his preface to the first stage of the Living Mirror. I quote, Я хочу дать представление о ленинградской поэзии за последние 20 лет, и я это сделаю. Эти стихи звучали в аудиториях и в Союзе писателей, перепечатывались на машинке и запоминались наизусть. Я не знаю, что такое авторское право. Автор имеет право на тексты, сохраняемые им в столе. Тексты же, свободно гуляющие по городу и городам, в течение 15 лет принадлежат уже не автору, а читающей публике. Автору же может принадлежать только гонорар. One might think that this principle of free circulation of texts in Samizdat was shared by default by all authors involved, but the case of Dmitry Bobushev, who didn't agree to the publication of his poems in the Living Mirror, tells us it was not. Within an official culture, Kuzminsky, however, was able to act according to his principle. In the introduction, he justified the publication of Bobushev texts with a direct message to him. Обидно, что Дима Бобушев с такой категоричностью отказывается принять участие в судьбе собственных текстов. Но это его дело. Я скажу ему: Дима, вы не можете вынуть себя из литературного процесса. Вас слушали, вас читали, вас знали. А я лишь фиксирую то, что известно многим. Ваш сборник стихотворений, отпечатанный на машинке в 1963 году, стал уже достоянием истории. И вы не можете запретить мне писать о вас, говорить о вас и цитировать вас, что я и делаю. И если я помню ваши стихи наизусть, то кому они принадлежат? Читателю или вам? Я думаю, что обоим. Так что подавайте в суд на рыцаря поэзии и пирата, а время, Господь, читатель, рассудят, кто из нас прав. Я люблю ваши стихи, на гонорар же не претендую. Я их собрал, я и печатаю. Дикси. It cannot be excluded that Brodsky, who had already immigrated to the United States, would have also opposed the publication of his poems in the Living Mirror, had he found out about the following words in Kuzminsky's introduction. О Бродском говорить нечего. Знаю его еще с января 59-го. Но другом не стал. Носился с его стихами, как с писаной торбой. Несколько лет. Сделали первую книгу его стихов с Ковалевым и Тайгиным. Создали легенду о Бродском. Сейчас пожинаем плоды. Рукопись его подарил кому-то. Мне он больше не нужен. Он нужен истории. А меня всегда интересовали живые поэты. Kuzminsky assumed such personal and sometimes presumptuous tone towards the authors in the Blue Lagoon because he considered his main goal to be above that. According to Lev Losev, the goal of such an anthology is not to collect the best, but to collect everything. Interestingly, it was the scope of the task that predeterminated the way the texts would be dealt with, wrote Kuzminsky. I quote, далеко не все авторы озаботились собственными подборками. Помимо того, с течением времени меняется отношение автора к ранним стихам, что создает дополнительные трудности. Автор желает печатать только последние тексты. Антология же замыслена как ретроспективная и репрезентативная, так что с волей автора не всегда возможно считаться. The anthology claimed to be retrospective and representative, and yet its editor openly stated, this is my version of the history of poetry for the last 25 years. However, Kuzminsky had to face editorial limitations when he tried to publish his anthology outside Samizdat. The second volume of the anthology was sent for review to Yuri Ivask, who appreciated neither the tone of Kuzminsky's lengthy notes nor his choice of material. Ivask recommended to abridge the volume by 50-60%, delete any poignant remarks, revise the critical articles, and most importantly, remove Kuzminsky as the only editor of the anthology. These comments could be ignored by not the demands of Brodsky and Bobushev to withdraw their poems. Kuzminsky had to comply to avoid the trial he mentions in the preface to The Living Mirror. Volume 2B came out later with the subtitle 2B без двух «Б», но зато со многими другими. And epigraph from Brodsky. Apart from this Kuzminsky project of the Leningrad period, I should mention the prose anthology Leprosorium 23, the unfinished poetry anthology Yuk that he made a part of the Lagoon, and his active participation in the poetry collection Lepta, the last attempts for the Leningrad Second Culture of the 70s to become a part of the official literature. Comparing them to the Blue Lagoon reveals a significant increase of the importance of the editor's comments and the college technique at all levels of the book, from composition of the materials to the design that Kuzminski and his wife Emma Podberezkina did themselves. Все это превращается в ткань поэмы ли, романа, антологии, принцип один, коллаж, wrote Kuzminski to Asa Meisel retrospectively on August 21, 1998. We can see a similar collage technique in Kuzminski's literary work of the 60s and 70s, especially the poem of Vilonskaya Bashna and the novel Отель zum Türken, that combine different languages, text and image, literary and newspaper text, and so on. His last book, Roman Gazeta, was an apogee of this genre. It is a retrospective collage of documentary, newspaper, and visual materials that sums up his literary work. In The Blue Lagoon, the context of the book was meant to emphasize its documentary character, the reproduced aesthetics of Samizdat, while the polemic biases, politically incorrect commentary by the editor, reflected certain corporality of this unofficial culture, which, according to Kuzminski, combined pure creative aspirations with the filth of the literary and Soviet life. I think that the intensity of Kuzminski's artistic gesture can be accounted for by the fact that he no longer felt he was a part of that literal body when he was working on his opus magnum, and the anthology was supposed to make amends for the fact that he was disconnected from his original environment. As we know, Kuzminski emigrated from the Soviet Union in summer 1975 and spent 6 months in Vienna. He planned to settle in Paris to work with Shemyakin at the Возрождение magazine. However, of all their joint projects, only the famous almanac Apollon 77 was completed. In January 1976, Kuzminski moves to the United States. He spent a few months at the Tolstoy farm and then moved to Austin, where he taught at the university for 2 semesters and then was the head of the Department of Literary Practice at the Institute of Modern Russian Culture at Blue Lagoon, hence the title of the anthology. That had just been established by John Bolt. It is important to point out that Kuzminski literary archive was sent through the Dutch embassy to Israel, where he was stuck, and it took Kuzminski a few years to get hold of it in full. For example, he only received both versions of the Living Mirror anthology in fall 1977. Thus, when he started lecturing at American universities or worked on publishing projects, he could only rely on his extraordinary memory. Among these projects was the unfinished book 20 Leningrad Poets in Text and Photo Materials that Kuzminski and his Austin student and future Slavic scholar Carol Emerson worked on in the end of 1976. Emerson's translations were published in the student magazines Ticket and Cheres. He had to give up hopes to publish selected works by Leningrad poets in the series of individual volumes. I quote, «Еще осенью земной, зимой 76-го, читая курс современной ленинградской поэзии шести профессорам и шести аспирантам, там же, в Техасе, естественно, по-аглицки, переводя на ходу исполняемые стихи подстрочником на ихнюю мову, задавал вопрос своему шефу Сиднею Монусу, а если хоть сборничками серии поэтов этих славики купят? Не, не купят, отвечал мудрый Сенька Монос, монастырский из украинских послепогромных эмигрантов. However, at the same time, Kuzminski and Alla Burago work on the translation into English of Yulia Vознесенская diary. She was a poet, a prominent activist of underground, member of the Lepta editorial board, and one of the organizers of the rally at the Декабристов Square in Leningrad on December 14, 1975. Kuzminski plunged into the study of the everyday life of the second culture, which encouraged him to create his own chronicle, as he later wrote. The initial idea was to publish a bilingual anthology at Texas Press using Paul Schmidt's translations, But Kuzminsky later found Philip Klendening at Oriental Research Press, who was ready to publish it in Russian without English translation, and decided to target Russian-speaking readers only. Kuzminsky's correspondence with the publisher shows that he was well aware of the scope of his audience. This is what he wrote in the letter to Klendening on August 6, 1979. I include the shortest version of an ad in Russian. We don't need American type, believe me. You can just send it to the mags and papers mentioned. Do not insist on big size. The names will speak for themselves. Just modern, just modest one. It's an anthology. Just more names than pretty words. Forgive me for teaching Russian kind of customer's psychology. Just believe me in this case. The very fact that the Kuzminsky anthology has not yet sold out, except for the first volume, and can be bought from the publishers, it's not, in my view, a result of Kuzminsky's or Klendening's poor knowledge of their target audience. Rather, it shows a particular quality of Kuzminsky's book that was, despite all its Kulturträger mission, a countercultural project. Kuzminsky created a cut-and-paste novel about unofficial culture, which I think deserves to be regarded as a separate literary genre. Yuri Miloslavsky, a writer and the character of the anthology, was among the first to point that out in his review. Это не антология, это роман в форме антологии. И все мы, или не мы, герои его романа. Поэтому я там совершенно спокойно встречаю никуда негодные стишки, графоманию, всякое бессмысленное трепыхание на задворках литературы школ. Это герои. Может же быть в романе герой и неудачный стихотворец. Ну, сказал 2-3 фразы и ушел. Immigration forcefully estranged and distanced Kuzminsky from his characters, and he chose the anthology with its cut-and-paste technique to create a unique literature of fact novel. Though published in Tamizdat, Kuzminsky hoped that it would reach Russia, but only if it were to preserve his commentary and design, including fonts and the poor quality of illustrations. The first volume was reprinted in Moscow in 2006, and internet made it easily available everywhere. Interestingly, Kuzminsky regarded internet as a new form of samizdat. This is how he summarized the fate of his anthology and its significance for a Soviet and post-Soviet reader in the letter to Asimaisen. А что невъебимо это для постсовковой интерни Цветкова, Кривулина, даже Осип Бродского, так я не для них писал, а для себя. Получилось и ладно. И кончилось в 86-м с приходом Горбачева. Сами уже смогли начать печататься. Незачем свиней вареньем кормить. Диетические Бродские, Ахматовы, им еще лет на 25 на жвачку хватит. Ну вот. А теперь прощаюсь, Ясенька Львовна, спасибо, что помните. А письмо можете запузырить в самиздат, к ксероксам. Оно, как и все, что я пишу, адресовано и конкретно, и абстрактно. Обращаясь к человеку, получается, не к одному. Thank you.